So look, the cities are being developed for thousands of years already. And as the first wave of development of cities, the main requirements to the development of this of such infrastructure as water, sewage, or waste, energy, utilities. So today we got over to the new phase of development, which is information. And the current technologies require a special infrastructure which should be in place in the city. And also, you might know that there exists such a concept as Internet of Things, which incepted at the beginning of the year 2000, according to our surveyors, in 2010. Around 2010, the number of population of the globe came up to the same number of devices switched into the internet. By 2020, we realized that we're going to have about 50 billion of such devices switched into the internet, and we have to do something about it. We need infrastructure, we need services. We will require for every city in the world an understanding of how we will develop this city from the point of view of technologies. So if those devices are united, are combined in one network, then we will get additional services and provide additional employment, thus upgrading the environmental, the ecologically sound city's status. The CISCO has its own concept, which is called the Internet of Everything, in continuation of the Internet of Things. We now realize that in the foreseeable future, and it is being even now implemented, that the era of comprehensive internet is coming. So I have a question to the internet, to the audience. Does anyone use the athletic bracelets, counting your steps? There are very few of us, but we exist. So look, it's a device that counts your steps, thus measuring your physical activity. You can compare yourself with your friends, your colleagues, and thus conduct some competitions or contests. It's an example of Internet of Things. So if this device is switched on to a server which your doctor, your physician is using, and your doctor will be watching or monitoring your physical activity. For instance, he had recommended you to walk not less than 10,000 kilometers, and then he can see that you stopped fulfilling his recommendations to be active in your life. He can change the approach to your treatment. But in continuation, our American colleagues decided to go even further. They said that the data from such bracelets should be given over to the insurance companies, because next year the insurance company, depending on your physical activity, may upgrade or downgrade your insurance policy. So this is an example of how technology might evolve in a year or two. So now about the concept of smart cities, or smart and connected communities, as we call them. We in CISCO realize that the city and its population are developing in different directions. Entertainment and sports and recreation and leisure, transport, work, and all those concepts should be linked in among it's among themselves, and the technologies should support the development. So we also realize that there are several concepts, separate concepts of smart houses, smart buildings, smart districts, and smart cities. So the territory we are currently in is the territory is so it's the city of Skolkovo, which is being built now, and you can see the roads and the utilities and several buildings have been constructed. But as a general concept for the city or for the town, the concept, underlying concept, is smart city. And my team was very active in developing this concept here. So, and the concept is being implemented currently. The city or the town has developed the portfolio of services. It would like to implement and the infrastructure which we have to have in place. And we believe that in 2 to 3 or maybe 5 years to come, the city will become smart. By implementing those services, we can now say that what happens is saving electricity, about 30% saved, and also water, and the criminal level about 20% also reduced, and traffic also reduced. For the city to become smart, of course, you can implement, introduce some services which will logically be introduced as first. But to develop the whole infrastructure, you have to develop a concept first. A concept starts with identifying your strategy, how the city is going to develop, then the necessary services should be selected, and infrastructural solutions should be prepared, and then the financial model should be calculated as to how those services are going to operate. Several examples of such services, of course, there's a huge number of them, about 250 we know of, and the number is growing. So such services as switched in technical servicing, when a management company receives information from all engineering systems, from the sensors that are put installed into the, in the equipment, thus upgrading the efficiency of operations and operational expenses are reduced. Separate solutions that are valid for green buildings, I mean the solutions that upgrade the energy efficiency, which is called GreenAware. Actually, entering a building, you will see a big switchboard which shows how much water, heating, office paper the building is consuming. Interactive kiosks with video, that's already being used in many places, and I'm sure many of you have seen things like that. Video conference, which is also a very effective solution, and you can see it in our demo center on the second floor of the neighboring building. Security, also very important for any city in Moscow, included. This system is being implemented in Moscow, and we are actively involved in it. Car parking management, very important type of service, which is quite lucrative and brings additional income to the city. Integrated management center. Many centers like that have been already implemented, and I'm sure Skolkovo is going to be the most advanced because we were involved in the designing of such center. There is a solution to collect garbage. A separate solution for management of garbage collection. It looks as follows. The garbage bins have sensors giving you information whether the bin is full or not and whether it's on fire or not. And thus, using the experience of European cities in Barcelona, they had done it already. In Nice and Munich, they are doing the same thing. So those solutions will allow us to reduce 30% of the cost of collection, garbage collection. The examples of already implemented projects. So it takes usually 5 to 10 years. If we take, for instance, the most advanced project in Korea, the Songmo city, it was built, the majority of the city, the biggest part of it was built, well, it took them 10 years, but they planned to finish it. Well, it's still in the development, and it will take them another 3 to 4 years to complete it. CISCO was an investor of the project, investor, consultant, advisor, and technological partner of the project. So you can go there, 8 hours of flight from Moscow, Incheon Airport in Korea, and 30 minutes by car. So it's very close to Moscow. In India, there are, of course, many projects like that with this concept. But the most interesting is the Skolkovo project, because we believe that this city is going to be smart, and in the nearest future, we will be able to touch it and see it. Colleagues, another thing to point. In the field of Internet of Things, we conduct a contest. So this slide doesn't want to stay. It's very active. But I am inviting you to participate. The reward is $250,000 US dollars. So you're welcome. Thank you. Questions? I'm ready. So it's about startup in Internet of Things and Internet of everything. IoT challenge, cisco.com. Let me get back to the picture about garbage collection. So all possible communication channels are used. Those, of course, it's Wi-Fi, if a city has it, and also it can be 3G. It can be just ordinary mobile connection or microphone, please. So for this, you have to first develop a project for a specific city, and there's no universal answer. You have to design it and develop it separately. Good afternoon. There are so many of you here. To be quite candid, we with Yuri didn't even think that for this kind of subject we'll be attracted by so many people. Well, what's the way we're going to talk? The organizers asked us to share the pluses and pros and cons, for the one person to say that the budget is something you should be involved in. The second will be saying that it's trash and it's crap, and we you don't. Well, please ask questions. So there are only three persons to ask questions. No one else would. So. The first couple of minutes, we will tell you of who we are, what we are doing, and then we are going to speak about our subject. Each of us will take 10 to 15 minutes to articulate our smart thoughts. Let's start. A couple of words about myself. My name is Andrei Komarovsky. I'm from St. Pete. We have a startup studio, we are launching global startups, not doing anything in Russia, using our own model. In a couple of words, we have piles of ideas, our own analysts, and good technical team, which consists of developers, designers, marketologists, so all guys that we need for the startups to be launched. So that's the second block of our model, and we have our own educational program, not bad. And it's not an accelerator because we are lecturing every day and trainings, conducting trainings. We're doing it for all year round. And we have our own investors that finance it, and also we invest our own money in the thing. The most important thing is that we so we take guys 25, 30 years old on board, those who want to do things, but they don't have many ideas, they don't have their own technical platform. So we give them teams, ideas, training programs, we drink together, and then things move on. This is what we're currently doing, and possibly we've been doing it already more than 12 months. Before that, I had my own startup, solid enough. I had been doing it for 3.5 years. We had production, patents, scientists. Still before, I had IT startups, and still before, I launched so many things, startups, no startups, and worked in a big business in sales and development. So a couple of words, that's in a couple of words about myself. Fewer words about me. Yuri Mitin, three things to know about myself. I'm developing the Startup Academy in the Business School of Skolkovo. Yesterday, about 150, 200 startuppers came to be trained how to present it to the Skolkovo. Skolkovo has many words. Skolkovo, Business School, Startup Village. So I represent Skolkovo Business School, 5 kilometers off here, big, beautiful building where they teach business. A big question whether you can teach business, but the founders like Ruben Vardanyan and Andrew Rapoport, Roman Abramovich, they say that they think that you can teach people business, and this is what I'm doing there in their business school. Last year, I created the business incubator for Lomonosov University. We train students and we develop projects, and now if you listen to Commerzant FM radio for 4 years, business case, success and failure stories together with Michael Homage, we are doing it. So, but we're here not to tell you what we are doing and about our plans, but about a specific thing, which is called growth hacking. And Andrei is the biggest expert, and I'm going to sort of challenging him or opposing. So that's for you to go. Yes, but actually, if you came here, you either have your own startup or you are going to have one. Well, at least you have something to do with the startup world. Can you raise your hands who already has a startup or will have one? Well, 70, 80 people will be asking questions today. So then I'm going to speak about the theory, and we'll try to relieve you of all the banalities. In Russian internet, mostly you can read about it in the English internet. The most important thing in startups, the critical thing in startup is to find what the people need. And every lecture say about that. Number one is you have to find something people need, and then everything will go great. We're not going to speak about that. It's the second critical thing in startup, which is growth. Because it so happens that even if you enter this great club of people who had found their own business models and what the people need, and you have your own product to offer, and you have a good retention level, then it so happens that your startup, which is the second reason why startups usually close, because guys don't know how to grow. So they do have a product, they have customers, everything clear, but it doesn't grow. But growth is the most important thing investors look at. There's a very famous word, traction. And if we don't theoreticize a lot, traction is the quantitative proof of market demand. How many items of your products you've sold, how many customers you've attracted, and how much money you've spent for that.
And we'll speak about how to give a startup growth that won't cost you millions. And that's a very important idea because, you know, look, you have a startup. And, for instance, you have some money for investments. And it so happens that you compete with established businesses, corporations in the market for the current channels to get to the clients. You compete with them, and it turns out that corporations do it a million times better because they've been in the market for quite a period so far, and they know how to do that. And now you come and say, I'll show you. But in practice, it turns out that it doesn't work that way. And you have to find such channels to your audience, to your customers, those who pay you for your product. And there is such thing as growth hacking. And it's a recent term. It was coined 2 or 3 years ago by a citizen of San Francisco. I don't remember his name. Growth hacking is how to provide budget growth for a startup, because successful guys in the Valley and New York, in the United States, that you should focus on growth. You shouldn't spend a lot on marketing, because you do not need such thing. They say, we fired all marketing people. And well, I think that marketing does not exist, because how a thing should exist with 100, with 200 definitions. One says marketing is this, another says marketing is that, KPIs, GRs, and analytics. All those things are about marketing, but startups on such initial stages do not need that. First, they need someone to buy your product, since you spent your time and money on things people will buy. I do not want to spend my life doing things people do not need. And you want the thing to grow. If you just create a product and 3 people buy it and that's it, then what will you do next? How will you earn money? So that's why growth hacking happened. And it's not about marketing at all. It focuses on growth entirely. And some people say that mostly growth hacking is an IT thing altogether. IT is about growth hacking. But if your startup is a hardware startup, you, for instance, create a very interesting device, it's not growth hacking. Well, mostly yes. But there is such company as Puma. Puma, when Pele was was very active, and Puma thought about how to attract those millions, billions of people who watch the FIFA World Cup to buy their products. And the competition was tough, and it is tough today. But for Puma, it was quite a challenge. It was not super number one brand in the world. There were Reebok and Nike and others with large budgets, but Puma had their contract with Pelé. And a representative of Puma approached Pelé before the championship started, and he said, well, you should stumble or fall, and then you just have to lace, to do your laces for quite a long period of time. Could you please do that? And all cameras broadcasted how he did his laces. So it was not marketing or something. It was a small thing, very cheap one, attracted that attracted a huge audience, and it was then a good conversion afterwards. And another company, am I on time? Yes, I'm fine with how it goes. Uber, another company. You might be aware of that. Well, it's like Yandex Taxi Get, but cooler and more beautiful, the service of personal drivers. And having huge investments, it's hard to make people just abandon their cars and use taxi services. It's not just yellow taxi, it's black S-Class Mercedes and A6 Audi and some other types of cars. So they give you a black car and say that it's your personal driver service, and no branding on those cars. Well, it looks cool. I used it for some time, and people thought how we could attract people. Everyone uses their own car or they hire a taxi. And what they focus on? They focus on a very narrow audience, potential audience, IT guys, because they are innovators. They are prepared to try new things. And they started sponsoring, very targeted sponsoring of IT events, and they granted free of charge rides on their cars, and people started talking about the service, and their organic growth was amazing. They didn't invest during previous year or two. They didn't invest into advertising, and the guys work on all continents across the globe, and the growth is amazing. 0 rubles on advertising, and that's a good example, good case. And a couple of words about growth hackers, guys, those who deal with growth. And they should be very analytical, because they make all decisions based on analytics. In Coffee Lab, we train all analytics. We are very good in analytics in mobile applications, web services. It's our holy grail, Alpha and Omega, and our main thing to work with. And these guys should be good analysts, and they should be also creative enough in order to create various cool things. What do I mean? I mean hacks and tricks and things that might help a startup to have a good boost, to have a good start. And those guys are, you know, they should be good in psychology, usability, design, and this should cover the maximum number of areas related to the project. Why? To the product. Why? Because if a person doesn't know about how the code is done, and if he doesn't know about behavior of people in his or her mobile application or web service, he cannot create a quality enough solution for his startup. So this training is always on, and we have a growth hacker on the team but he spent about 18 months on such things. So that's it. No, it's not it. It's just the beginning. An alternative version about growth hacking and this saying that you do not need marketing. Let's look at Russian entrepreneurs, those who work in Russia with its own specificity, investments, connections, startups. Another word I cannot articulate it. Various techniques of clients attraction and entrepreneurs. Fedor Chinnikov, a good case. Are you aware of him? Did you hear about him? Yes, up to 10 people heard about him. So he wanted to start his own business 7 years ago in the city of Syktyvkar. A classic business, a bookstore. A bookstore. Well, just imagine, you're in Syktyvkar, you want to open a bookstore, you need to find money. Do you think about growth hacking? No, you think about a trading mall to start your store in, and you then take money from your family, and you take a loan, and you buy special bookshelves, and you buy books, and you're on the floor. So, and you know that on the third floor there is another bookstore, and you have no money, and you have to promote your business in Syktyvkar. What should you do? What should we do? Advertising. Well, you do not have any money. No advertising on TV. Your own booklets, leaflets to distribute things in the streets, and start a blog. Yes. That's true. Siloma, that's his title for the blog. And that's how it goes in the business. Hi, my name is Fedor. I'm something years old, and I spent this amount of money on my business, and I do not have zero clients. That was his first posting. And everyone thought he's a crazy guy, but interestingly enough, those who noticed him on the internet started coming to him. They didn't use a bookstore on the third floor. They chose his bookstore on the second floor, but people from Erich Krause or other staples stationery. Things and you can see a posting from not very much satisfied supplier, and what should we do? To delete the post or to let it stay? And Fedor decided to let it stay where it was, and they declined the supplier. And another supplier came and said, we will give you the same product but cheaper. And Fedor sold his network, six bookstores altogether by the end of the day. And then he started another business, pizza business. And the same blog is on, and Fedor worked to McDonald's to know how things are out there, and then get back to his business, and started creating a company a billion worth. And he sold one business and he started the second. Well, we might believe this guy. And I think that marketing always helps, and zero marketing, when you use a blog and you are sincere enough, it might save you. It's Russia. But if you want more details on this story, well, this guy sometimes comes to Skolkovo and speaks about his success story. And the book was even published, and it was titled Even Geeks Can Do Business. So let's look at the United States. Awful things happen out there. 10 times more people use internet, and they all have their credit cards. What happens out there? Let's look at the next slide. Two cases. One case. You might be aware of this service, Dropbox. Do you know about that? Great. Well, before I start talking about this story, founder, Mr. Drew, he traveled from Boston to New York, and he forgot his flash stick. He needed his flash stick, so he's He was traveling from Boston to New York, and he thought it would be great to have a software to download the material I have on my stick. And then he created the software, and he prepared a 4-minute video. We're not going to watch it now, but it was created in a way that and that integrated interesting tricks for geeks, those who are interested in your product. 3% of people who won't give you bring you millions, but those that will send things to their friends, and they will come to you. And so photos of Steve Ballmer and a piece of secret code. And this video had 286,000 views in 5 years. But all this 100,000 viewers downloaded Dropbox. And the investors said that your competitors are Google and Microsoft, but 100,000 people downloaded and tried it. And now the company is worth $4 billion or something. Well, 250 million, that's what they raised, and they are assessed at the level of about $4 billion. And the video is great, and they are also great. But 14 million, more than 14 million views for the video, that ads promotes razors under subscription. You know, the service says you do not need a razor $20. We can offer you $1 razor. Let's watch the video. It's a unique, unique moment. A virus video gets 14 million viewers, and growth hacking is not something which that matters here. After that.
Our blades are f***ing great. Each razor has stainless steel blades and aloe vera lubricating strip and a pivot head. It's so gentle a toddler could use it. And do you like spending $20 a month on brand name razors? 19 go to Roger Federer. I'm good at tennis.
And do you think your razor needs a vibrating handle, a flashlight, a back scratcher, and 10 blades? Your handsome ass grandfather had one blade and polio. Looking good, pop up! Stop paying for shave tech you don't need. And stop forgetting to buy your blades every month. Alejandro and I are going to ship them right to you. We're not just selling razors. We're also making new jobs. Alejandro, what were you doing last month?
Not working.
What are you doing now?
Working.
I'm no Vanderbilt, but this train makes hay. So stop forgetting to buy your blades every month and start deciding where you're going to stack all those dollar bills I'm saving you. We are DollarShaveClub.com, and the party is on.
So 1.5 minutes presentation, 14 million views. And the question is, how I'm going to find investors or customers? No such question. And growth hacking, the floor goes to Andre. Well, may I interrupt you? It's like an argument between us. You know, what Yura showed is cool and great, but first of all, in the United States, there is only one person who can pitch this. There are no other videos with the founder or CEO of startup. No one can pitch like that, neither in Russia nor in the United States. And what Yura showed is a very good tactics of growth hacking and how you using your advantages. Well, this guy speaks very good and looks good, and the video is great. And they didn't do a project, the product, but everyone thought that yes, that's a cool thing. But it's well, when you do marketing in Russia, it looks in a different way. 2008, before the crisis, club Rai, nightclub Rai, two TV anchors, Dmitry Dibrov, Lev Novozhonov, they announced that we are going to launch a new intellectual network for highbrow people. people. So girls around Champaign, everything is great. 600,000 people should be attracted, top for top. That's the title for it. And the investment is about $15 million. $5 million went for TV ad prime time, various primetime ads. Dmitry Dubrov says you need a real social network, not Одноклассники, but a real highbrow social network. Housewives were not interested at all. $5 million TV ad. And just a bit, in order to have the website, you have to have the latest Flash player. Otherwise, you cannot open the website. And that's the curve of the growth. $15 million was written off, but a great step to bring people from TV to internet. So that's marketing in Russia. I think that we should teach marketing. We do it in our school. It's your turn now. And yes, as I already said, these guys that do growth hacking, they should be very good analytics, and they should know various analytics systems. When they work, the first thing to start with is to create a funnel. And in the valley, they identify five blocks of funnel, three main blocks attracting people, activating people, and retaining people. And those guys say that there is referral and revenue, money. Well, my personal opinion is that, well, I cannot agree with that, because money and referrals, they might come from retention or activation, but we do not identify them, we do not define them as a separate block. And if you achieved retention, money will come, and referrals, well, yes, it is needed, and you will work for that, but holy grail of growth and growth hacking is already there if conversion and retention is quite good. Well, it depends on the market and the stage of your startup development, but if it is more than 70% of users who stay with you, then that's an achievement indeed. And we start working with growth hacking, creating the funnel. And for each funnel, for each block of the funnel, we have our own strategies of methods and tactics of growth hacking. How you can realize what these blocks are? Well, attracting people means as if you go to a blind date. Everyone in the United States does that. And you go to a blind date, you do not know what will happen, but you do it. The first thing is to attract people through various channels. You can give context through ads or do PR steps, or you can cheat people. But there are lots of methods to attract people to your landing, to your point of sales. There are millions of them out there. But the thing is that people come to you because you promise them something. For instance, I can bring tens or thousands, hundreds of thousands of your landing just by doing a context ad. I sell BMW for $5, one thousand units in the stock. Come to us and check it out. Well, people will come and think, interestingly enough, BMW $5 price tag, but at the same time, they understand that there is some trash on your website, and they understand that they are cheated. But the second step is activation. Activation might be perceived as creating relationship with a girl. So you attracted her, you went to a blind date, and now you have to develop these relations with her, and that's activation. Activation. might be types of activation might be different. So you have to users have to do some steps to subscribe for your mailing or something else. But even if people did that or bought something, it doesn't mean that you would retain people. So you spend a lot of money to attract people. They come to you, they buy, they try, but they do not like it, and they say goodbye and leave. And that's the problem. And we have to do something with those guys. We have to provide retention. And trying your product or a prototype, they should stay with us after that. So it's like marriage. When you married, when you got married, you can be sure, that your mission of growth hacking is completed, and so this girl you chose stays with you. Yes, a very interesting analog with marriage, but retention, what is it then? Well, does it mean that you break up? So here is relations and here is marriage. If there is no marriage and she left you after the fifth date, again, about the funnel for marketing attraction, when you attract people and you say that very good presentation, come to us, conversion. After presentation, five people exchange their business cards, and retention, that's when people get back a year later. So it's something like marketing, isn't it? You steal from the marketing. Not exactly. The standard marketing funnel, yes, but it's not only marketing funnel, but it's also sales funnel. So partly. So for all blocks, there are strategies and tactics and methods of growth hacking. What do we do to attract people, to activate people, and then to retain this guy, to make him stay with us? Just in a nutshell, I'll touch upon basic strategies and tactics. Globally, there are three strategies of growth hacking in order to attract people on your website or your point of sales or your product. Pull strategy, push strategy, and the product strategy. In Russian, pull strategy means you create a value for a user, and this value might be translated into creation of a guide or a blog or working with social networks, even in SEO. So the thing is that you do not pay directly per each user, and you create something for which with which you attract your people. It's not context or ad. People just come to you because you do something cool and interesting. Another strategy, push strategy. It means that you pay directly per each client to visit you, you know, per each head. You pay for each head, and it might be traffic exchange or direct sales or ads. For some startups, direct sales, you know, it's the most expensive one and the most complicated. They might work quite well. And strategy number three, the coolest one in terms of growth hacking.
And here I would say that it can be used only in IT startups. Well, it seems to me, at least, well, because I haven't encountered any other examples. And in my startup, I could not use this strategy. But the sense of it is that your product might have something that might drive the growth by itself, for instance. For instance, if it's WhatsApp mobile application or whatever, so and guys using your notebook, it's super critical, important, and they are using it all around. And they can do messaging, and they say that this friend has it and the other doesn't have. So it's the feature of the product. The second group of hackers or tactics is to activate the users, to build up relationship, and for this, what you do landings, you do landing pages, you hire a cool copywriter or study yourself, learn, you spend a lot of time to learn writing text. I think that in IT startup, more than 50% of the work is writing texts, because more than 50% of your time you spend in writing text for websites, in Google Play, for your sales, for press releases, and you are dealing with the press. So it's piles of text, because if you don't know how to write text, well, it's too bad. You have to have a copywriter using different services. And we have American copywriters. They are writing all those things because our founders, they cannot write in English so well. And our Russian IT people cannot write English. Well, I don't know how they do it. Maybe they learn how to, because users usually read what you write. And if you don't know how, then and then those buttons the users click, it's also trivial. And I would say only that here the call to actions and orange and salad green and Tahoma. So if you don't know what kind of font you should use, take Tahoma, because onboarding is too complicated. It's too cool a thing, and you have to do in every IT startup. If you because if you don't have it, you are just well, onboarding a couple of words. It's similar to just taking the user by your hand for him to understand the value of your product. You come to the airport and they don't, well, we come to an airport and think, where's the customs, where to go, when they're going to check your passport, or so they take you by the hand and show, here is, please take your address, go to the show, come here, show your passport, come here, register your tickets. So it's onboarding, because you were accompanied in the airport all the time. Well, demification is a separate subject. A lot is written already in the Russian language internet. You can read. The smart pricing is something like, have you ever seen that, well, in 99% of landings and services, there are three options of prices, at least three. You would never say one big price and nothing else. Three options. Actually, 99% of one option sells. The other two are needed to justify the pool you sell your prices, your product at. So there's research. When you come to a supermarket and you say, and he says a coffee machine and there's 200 bucks, then he said, no, it's too expensive. And for the second time he comes, again, it's 200 still. And next to it, absolutely similar, but 350. Absolutely similar with some additional function, yellow colors. He said, cool, cool deal, good offer, almost the same, but at 200. And then the coffee machines are sold well. That's smart pricing. And the last block of the funnel, it's retaining your customers and tactics. We have 15 minutes to go. You have 15 minutes to go. I have only 1 second. Five. Folks, just take photos. Take the pictures of this. Very important is to faster. I will speak about two most important things. Very important is to do as fast as possible, give an opportunity to your target audience and customers to feel the effect, the benefit of your product. Very important for him to understand what you can offer, the value he pays for. Some services getting the value is delayed to 1 or 2 weeks. We used to have such thing in startups, so it was very difficult because you know people get registered for some time. He clicks on, but the value providing is postponed till 2 weeks, and we were losing on the way almost everybody. But we solved it. And the second most important thing is that if you generally produce a so good a product that everybody loves it, and not just very good, not just a loaf of bread, but something so good, so cool, the people would recommend it and will tell stories about it, which is organic growth. Everybody wants organic growth, but the reality is less than 1% of startups will acquire this kind of organic growth, and there's no algorithm as to how provide this organic growth. And I think that the shortest way is to do something but absolutely cool. Let it be even a loaf of bread, but it should be so cool, a loaf. Your examples, you wanted examples or processes. Process, yes, please take a picture of the process. Please take photo. It's our invention, and in the internet, it's difficult, it's impossible to find. We use this process to go. It's the algorithm for us. Algorithm, what to do? It's cool. It works. I was bragging a little bit. And about examples, I was speaking about Uber company and their tactics. They used at each stage of the funnel and what they did to attract users and to activate to retain them. To attract customers, they used the push strategy. They paid per each customer, per each user or passenger, just sponsoring quite handsomely all the IT events. To comment, it will take us 3 to 4 hours. Briefly, 1.5 hours. Build up your funnel. Attraction, activation, and retention of users. The funnel, the numbers of the funnel you get from the research. For instance, in your funnel, you will see the following numbers. Attraction of users is 100 people a month or a day, it doesn't matter. Then activated, 60% of them at the second block. And retention, 3%, it's too bad. Then you can see those spots. Why? Because you have too few users. You have to work at attracting users. And then another of your issue is number three funnel block. Conversion to retention is only 3%. And you can see that the percentage of activated is 90 and the percentage of retention is 70. So that's cool. The users, 50 users, so you have to work at the first number. So the funnel will give you a tip at what block you'll have to work at. And when you see the thing, you will construct your experiment. You will choose the tactics from cross-hacking, and you'll start working at the channel to increase this number. Uber has a very good retention level, cool retention. Why so? Because their service is so good. I don't want to defend others. Or Yandex Taxi or Uber's service is cool, and people are telling things about it. I'm not. I never tell people that I'm using Yandex Taxi. You know, I used Yandex Taxi good. No, I don't. But People who ever once used Uber, he tells stories how cool it is. And guys, I mean, Uber gets a great inflow of new users or passengers or clients or whatever you call them, which they acquire through organic growth. They hadn't visited or attended IT events. So they didn't see ads. I learned from my American friends the push strategy, onboarding, and cool product. A very good experience of interaction with product, which for the company did a great job. Yes, let's look now at another slide, alternative version. Well, it seems to me that at the beginning you will have to find out first where's your market, and because to do the cross-hacking and to review it from the scalable growth without finding the niche is sort of bizarre. We looked at the previous video when the founder said you have to buy bread by subscriber. The young person and the girl, they were reading the Lean Startup book, How Not to Spend Huge Amount of Money, and if you don't find your niche, how to reposition. So before you start the cross hacking and marketing, maybe you'd first find out who your client is, and then double check whether the customer is going to buy from you. And if it matches, then you should go on and develop. Then you will see the ACR and AR cycle. If it doesn't work, then go back and revisit number one point. A lot of books have written about that, business models, the structuring, Bob Dorf, Steve Banks, and many startups say that we are not going to shoot money into the air. So, and there was a seminar devoted to lean startup. So I think we should start with this, because if you use this example, there can be both positive and negative stories. I will give you some successful, and then we recap and answer questions. Story number one, technological startup. The founder, I was the founder in 2011, went to the States. It was Upifia, geolocation. When you write, for instance, in your telephone, go to Seventh Continent or Pericrostic to buy fruit and vegetables, go to the drugstore to buy some pharmaceuticals, and then after work, you will have to go home, and geolocator says that here is the pharmacy, here is the Auchan, and you have to pop in. So good idea, good entrepreneur, and he spoke about the hopes and fears, how he failed. He raised the $50,000 from business angels, didn't stop because it sounded great, and the next thing was $80,000 from Microsoft. Good story, visit to the States, an attempt to present, and in the States they said that Google, we do have it in Google now. Well, they do have, Apple has something like that, and Yandex Navigator, and you can have the same. Said, no, no problem, it will be developed, let's do it by cross-hacking. They said, okay, a year passed, and then same Alexei Kosterian. He said, it's not the case when you have to look at the failure stories that, yes, we knew it. Well, he was honest enough to share it, move on, and did a new business. In the States, it's a tradition to share the failure, because, well, it's a great approach, but in Russia, no one is fond of telling you about a failure story. And almost impossible to find in Russia. But he said, we spent money not to double check the clients or marketing or focus groups or even conferences, but for development. We're looking for some interesting applications and then launched for Android, then Apple platform, iOS, and $130,000 dug into the earth. And there was a lot of hacking, no cross. There are other situations when people think, well, forget it about cross-hacking, let's do whatever. And then one of the business school Denis Pugac graduated from business school Skolkovo. Two projects. One is Yandex Market for supermarket. When you you want your cycle simulator, well, you sorted the delivery, then you have to buy milk, fruit, and whatever you have to buy in a separate shop. What are the versions? Utkonos, and online hypermarket, you, well, personal individual delivery, and he comes with this idea to business school Skolkovo. Well, just ordinary people who are doing it, who are, want to save, and the consultants ask. Maybe there's another idea to double check it. You know, he said, there's another small business I have. We are selling shawarma at not at 1, but at 300 rubles, but in a great cart and do it at festivals. Okay, let's do this. There was a Fisher Food Festival, and Dennis, you should know Dennis. Dennis is wearing red trousers with a big beard, with an April, green April, shawarma coming by. And the Fisher Food Festival sold 1,000 pieces of shawarma at 500. It was not a startup even, or even a talk of online hypermarket. So now we are scaling his business model. Cart, the third cart is being ordered. It's a separate success story, which is called the Street Food from Amsterdam, Durum Durum, that's the title, and you can look up. No marketing, no conferences for Startup Village, just selling it at festivals. In restaurant business, the three factors of success, location, location, and location. The better you're located, the better your sales. And another story, when IT startup is digitalizing, and for instance, if you want to buy from internet your mobile, and you can see it from all the sites, in many internet stores, you can have it, you can have several photos of different sites, but it's very difficult to sell it because there are competitors, and when we talked with this guy at Kommersant FM radio, he said, well, it's simple. We are just developing websites during our leisure time. For instance, we come to a customer selling fishing rods and fishing. He said, let's do your site. He said, OK, here's the price. So here are the ways in from the sites. We showed it to you for you to understand what kind of an opinion or for what's closer to you, and then we exchange business cards. Briefly, the numbers of the people we attract here in business Skolkovo Business School, well, we have those investors accessible around the year, and many of our teachers, our professors, as I have Vice, for instance, he's talking to us, sharing. We have teachers, we have professors. We try to upgrade them to the next level, those startuppers, and maybe get them acquainted to with founders like Kusnirovich, Abramovich, and whomever. We can give you our contacts. You can see them on the slide. Now better Q&A, or maybe recap. Well, sort of unexpected. A very smart thing, small thought to articulate. If you find 100 people of your potential customers, just 100 people, and you will talk to them personally every day, every bloody day. We in Coffee Lab has our own term. Practically, somehow, we don't. No one does it. But if you find only 100 people, you will use them as a trial animals, and to ask the right questions, to drink them, to go to sauna, congratulate them on their birthdays. In 12 months, you will have the coolest product. But no one does that. Everybody's relying on landings on whatever, that's all crap. Find the 100 people who would use your product, and if it's the their products, then you'll be cool. Thank you. So do we have time left for us, or we have 5 minutes? Any questions? We have 5 minutes. We have 5 minutes to go. Nikita Bogdanov, my question, what's the difference of cross hacking from marketing? Unfortunately, I didn't hear it from you. What's the difference between cross hacking and marketing? You said that you are going to oppose to each other, and I didn't hear any opposition or challenging. Yes, we did. Answering your question, marketing is everything. Marketing has 200 different tips, but marketing doesn't have a focus. You will do everything. Gross hacking is matching marketing, but it's not marketing. It's to provide fast budget growth with its own tactics. Marketing doesn't have it. For instance, you take a classical marketologist like Kotler. There's nothing of the kind there. Kotler is the guru of marketing, and in management, he's the guru. Yes, questions. Did we answer your question? Yes. Practical question. In Facebook, Casa Badlo, 46 comments, 250 of likes. We have a project. We 100 euros go there to take photos of yourself. They said, "Oh, what a freak!" So, well, you have to change your friends and the Facebook. Well, seriously speaking, it's irrelevant matrix, and people matrix is the indicator not related to your business. In the process, even photo taken some. There's actionable metrics, which is related to your value and delivery, and likes, comments, and tweets. It's all crap. I can give you 100,000 of at three copies. It will not help you to grow and provide growth. Colleagues, more questions? It's an open discussion. Microphone for everyone to hear. Are there any examples in Russia of successful gross hacking? Yuri, are there any successful examples of Russian gross hacking? Yes, there are examples. I personally would not recollect them. Not because there are none, but because folks just don't write about them. As I said, it's a relatively recent term, well, 2 years only. But maybe at Hobson First and Silicon, someone writes something. Just Google around and you will see. But I don't know. We are doing startups for the USA, and we are not doing it for Russia. That's because me, personally, I'm not interested in Russian gross hacking. For the USA and for the world, it's not very relevant, and we don't want to. Well, that's it from us. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, the organizers. Thank you very much. Any business cards, Q&A offline? Thank you.